We will get back to the breaking news on Dick Clark in a moment. Wolf Blitzer is on his way back from NATO headquarters in Brussels, where he sat down today with Secretary of State Hillary Clinton and Defense Secretary Leon Panetta for an exclusive joint interview. They discussed a wide range of topics, including the U.S. drawdown in Afghanistan, the nuclear threats from Iran and North Korea, and the presidential election at home. Listen to this.
On Syria, is President Bashar al-Assad, according to your opinion, Madam Secretary, a war criminal?
I'm not going to get into the labeling, Wolf, because what I'm doing now is trying to see whether or not he is going to implement Kofi Annan's plan. And I don't think it's useful to do anything other than focus on the 6 points of the plan. Right now, it doesn't appear, once again, that he is going to follow through on what he has pledged to the international community he will do. We are still working to see about getting monitors in to be able to have an independent source of information coming out to the Security Council. I will be going to Paris tomorrow afternoon to meet with like-minded nations in an ad hoc meeting to take stock of where we are. But it was significant that the Security Council endorsed Kofi Annan's six-point plan. The Syrian government said they would abide by it. And yet we still see shelling going on in homes in Idlib and other places.
Are these crimes against humanity?
I think what we want to do is begin an accountability project to gather evidence. We really don't want to be labeling what we see, which are clearly disproportionate use of force, human rights abuses, absolutely merciless shelling with heavy weaponry into unarmed civilian areas. Even shelling across borders now into Turkey and Lebanon has happened last week. We're interested in stopping the behavior, but at the same time, we do want to see evidence collected so that there could be in the future accountability for these actions.
It sounds like the answer is yes. You do believe these are crimes.
Don't put words in my mouth. We're not making those kinds of charges or claims. Our goal right now is if the Assad regime were to say, okay, we agree, we're going to do everything that Kofi Annan asks us to do, that would be our focus, not some future, maybe unlikely outcome in terms of criminal accountability. What I'm interested in is let's stop the violence, let's start the political transition.
Senator McCain says the U.S. should take the military lead in arming the rebels, maybe even going forward with a no-fly zone. Here's the question. We're at NATO headquarters, Mr. Secretary. Is NATO impotent in Syria right now?
I don't think so. I think that NATO, frankly, has shown that it can take on
in Libya,
the
it did, but in Syria, Libya, it's not doing
Libya
anything.
Libya did a great job, and it shows that when the international community comes together and decides to take action, that we can take action that achieves the result we
the
want.
The argument is that Libya...
In this situation, the international community... Wolf has not made that decision.
If it does, would NATO take action?
If the international community makes the decision that we have to take further steps, we'll be prepared to do that.
A no-fly zone, arming the rebels, all of that.
I mean, obviously, that would have to be discussed as part of whatever plan is required in order to achieve the mission.
Any chance China and Russia will go forward with what they did in Libya and allow such a resolution to go forward at the UN Security Council?
Well, right now, that's a long shot. There doesn't seem to be any willingness on their part to go further than where we are right now. But this is a fast-changing situation, and, countries have a lot of relationships. We know that there are relationships certainly with Syria. There are also relationships with Turkey. There are relationships with the Gulf. There are relationships with European countries, all of whom are very worried about what will happen if Syria either or both descends into civil war or causes a larger regional conflict. So I don't think we are even, I don't think we're halfway through this story yet, Wolf. We're going to see a lot happen over the next few weeks, and it truly is up to the Assad regime. They're the ones who hold it in their power to end the violence and begin the political
transition. How much
time
do they have?
Well, I mean, they're running out of time because they've made so many promises which they've never kept. So their credibility, even with those countries that support them...
Like Russia and China.
Like Russia and China, is beginning to fray.
North Korea. Mitt Romney says the Obama administration's, in his words, incompetence emboldened the North Korean regime and undermined the security of the United States and its allies. You want to respond to the presumptive Republican presidential nominee?
No, not necessarily.
Why don't you anyhow?
But I
he
think,
makes a serious charge incompetence.
No, I think it's pretty clear that this administration took a firm stand with regards to the provocative behavior that North Korea engaged in. We made clear that they should not do it. We condemn that action, even though it was not successful and it was a failure. The fact is it was provocative, and we have made very clear to them that they should not take any additional provocative actions. I think that was a clear, strong message that not only our country but the world sent to North Korea, and that's the way, frankly, the United States ought to behave.
If they do an underground nuclear test, for example, what would you do?
That would be, again, another provocation.
So what would you do?
And it would worsen our relationship. I'm not going to get into how we would respond to that, but clearly we are prepared at the Defense Department for any contingency.
Still 30,000 U.S. troops along that demilitarized zone between
right.
North and South Korea. A million North Korean troops, almost a million South Korean troops, nuclear arms. This is a very dangerous part of the world.
No question. You know, we're within an inch of war almost every day in that part of the world, and we just have to be very careful about what we say and what we do.
Does that keep you up at night more than any other issue?
Well, unfortunately, these days, there's a hell of a lot that keeps me awake, but that's one of the ones at the top of the list.
What are the others?
Well, obviously, Iran, Syria, the whole issue of turmoil in the Middle East, the whole issue of cyber war, the whole issue of weapons of mass destruction, rising powers. I mean, all of those things are threats that the United States faces in today's world.
You got a lot of issues over there. What do you think of this new young leader of North Korea, Kim Jong-un? Not even 30 years old yet.
Well, we really are waiting and watching to see whether he can be the kind of leader that the North Korean people need. I mean, if he just follows in the footsteps of his father, we don't expect much other than the kind of provocative behavior and the deep failure of the political and economic elite to take care of their own people. But he, you know, he is someone who has lived outside of North Korea, apparently, from what we know. We believe that he may have some hope that the conditions in North Korea can change. But again, we're going to watch and wait. He gave a speech the other day that was analyzed as being some of the old, same old stuff and, you know, some possible new approach, but it's too early.
You know, when I was in Pyongyang in December 2010, I was amazed that I could see CNN International in my hotel room. They watch CNN and I very closely.
Mm-hmm.
If you had a chance to speak to Kim Jong-un, even a sentence or two, what
right.
would you say to him?
I would say that as a young man with your future ahead of you, be the kind of leader that can now move North Korea into the modern world, into the 21st century. Educate your people, open up your system, allow the talents of the North Korean people to be realized. Move away from a failed economic system that has kept so many of your people in starvation. Be the kind of leader who will be remembered for the millennia as the person who moved North Korea on a path of reform. And you have the opportunity to do that.
Are you ready to meet with them?
Well, under you know, circumstances that don't exist today, the United States, as you know, was willing to try to reach out to him, which we did. We had several high-level meetings. We agreed to provide some food aid in return for their ending some of their uranium enrichment and missile development. And then they do what has been already termed by Leon and the rest of the world as a provocative action. So it's hard for us to tell right now, is this the way it will be with this new leader? Or does he feel like he has to earn his own credibility in order to have a new path for North Korea? Too soon to tell.
This story of these military personnel in Cartagena, it's a shocking story. And I know I can only imagine when you heard about the prostitutes and Secret Service agents and U.S. military personnel, I can only imagine, Mr. Secretary, what went through your mind. But tell us what went through your mind.
Well, I don't usually use those words in public, but it was very disturbing. And the reason it was disturbing is that whether it takes place in Colombia or any other country or in the United States, We expect that our people will behave according to the highest standards of conduct. That obviously didn't happen here, and as a result, we're investigating the matter, and as a result of that investigation, we'll hold these people accountable.
Diplomatic fallout from this incident? It's unfortunate, obviously.
Oh, I don't think so much diplomatic fallout as the unfortunate fact that it certainly ate up a lot of the coverage of the summit, which was a meaningful get-together. It only happens once every 3 years. An opportunity to showcase Colombia. Think about how much Colombia has changed. And the United States, with our Plan Colombia support, has really been at the forefront of helping Colombia emerge as a real dynamo in the region. As Leon said, there'll be investigations both in the military and in the Secret Service. You know, I've had Secret Service protection for more than 20 years, and, you know, I've only seen the very best, the professionalism, the dedication of the men and women who have been around me and my family.